This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world. Today we're talking to someone with a very different vision of the UFO and close encounter alien phenomenon than you're used to hearing about, because Charles Upton is Muslim and takes a viewpoint of this that is very different from what you might have heard, in particular from the conventional Western vision of reality, and to a great extent also different from the Christian vision. Charles is a poet and metaphysician. He is from San Francisco. He's a protege of the Beat Generation, and to look at him and to look at me, you know, we probably both are to an extent. He's been a member of the psychedelic counterculture, and yet it seems eminently sane, nevertheless, still. He's a peace activist. He's a Sufi Muslim. He's a writer in the traditionalist perennialist school, and we'll learn about what that is. And he has co-founded with Dr. John Andrew Morrow an international Muslim interface peace movement known as the Covenants Initiative, and has been writing on the subject of UFOs since 2001. And his new book, The Alien Disclosure Deception, is what we will be discussing today, and also his ideas about this and how he comes to them, because it, in particular, as this thing becomes more focused in our world, it is terribly important that the ideas of people like Charles get a serious hearing. His website is charles-upton.com. Charles, welcome to Dreamland.
Well, glad to be here. And jumping right in, you say that my view as a Muslim is substantially different from the Christian view. And that is not my view.
I thought I said somewhat different.
Well, yeah, somewhat. The Muslim view is more nuanced, I would say. But I could certainly say that, you know, it's interesting that you say that my view is rarely heard. This shows a sort of encapsulation of what you call the conventional, you know, view of UFOs and, the, you know, the ufologist world. Because certainly my view is in line with that of many evangelical Christians, with at least one Sufi sheikh, Nurjan Mirhammadi, who's a Naqshbandi sheikh, an Eastern Orthodox priest, Father Spiridon Bailey from United Kingdom. And, you know, there's a lot of background, there's a lot of material on an understanding of, let us say, the more sinister aspects of the UFO phenomenon that are found in both Christianity and Islam, and that they're not that different. There are some important differences, though, which I will address. So,
well, one of the things I wanted to talk about, I think by talking about it, we'll get into the subject in a useful way. Mm-hmm. Is your vision of the Netflix series Top Secret UFO Projects Declassified, and your understanding of what that series was actually doing and what it represents. You say, for example, in the blog on charlesupton.com about it, you mentioned something that has been very much on my mind for a long time. You say, evidence for this covert promotion appears in Top Secret UFO Projects Declassified when it asserts that whistleblowers who reveal what the government knows about the UFO phenomenon do so at risk of their lives, while at the same time presenting us with the findings of so-called whistleblowers like Colonel Philip Corso, Bob Lazar, Emery Smith, astronaut Edgar Mitchell, who have been operating freely for years, speaking, writing, and appearing in videos, apparently with no negative consequences. And I am acutely aware of this. I agree with you. It is true that, you know, I know a good bit of number of people inside the classified world, not necessarily connected with this, but just as a writer doing your, you come across such people, and they do not, whistleblowing is a very dangerous business. And yet these people who spout all of these secrets seem unbothered by any official sanctions. Why is that, Charles?
Well, it would seem to indicate, and of course I cannot prove this, but my informed speculation is that a double game has been being played from at least to the end of World War II about how to present UFOs to the public. I mean, there has been the official debunking of the UFO phenomenon that we're all familiar with, which is just this year and last year just changed. Now we have an official acceptance. But the debunking, you know, went for decades. But at the same time, there were these apparently targeted leaks of information that would seem to indicate that UFOs are real, that the intelligence community knows a great deal about them, you know, the myth that Eisenhower made a treaty with the aliens and all of this. All this stuff is being leaked at the same time. And it's being leaked by people associated with the intelligence community and the military. So there we have two different parallel stories. And what I would say is that when you see, you know, a contradiction like that being foisted upon the American people, it appears to be deliberate. And when contradictory bits of information are projected into the mind and the consciousness of the victim without any acknowledgement or indication that there is a contradiction, this has the effect of paralyzing the critical faculties of that person or of that population. And I think something like this is being done. And I think, you know, because, you know, social engineering and what has come to be called mind control is a science that has been studied intensively for generations, if not centuries, by people whose goal is to control populations. And I think this has been foisted upon us. You can look at a lot of the post-World War II science fiction movies as, you know, from a standpoint of there being propaganda films. One of the best examples of this is the film Red Planet Mars. And I'm right now, I do not remember the name of the producer of this, but I discovered that he had a background in producing propaganda films for the U.S. government during World War II. So we have, you know, what appears to be a continuing of the propaganda effort, but in another framework and for another purpose. So for some reason, it seems like the elements of the military-industrial intelligence community have been covertly, you know, standing behind and initiating a belief in UFOs while at the same time debunking them publicly. And why this is going on, you know, this is another area for speculation. But I think we have to realize that a lot of the things that are being projected about UFOs from many different sources, you know, from supposedly legitimate documentaries and completely fictional accounts and, you know, whatever crazy crank theory somebody may come up with, there's a vast amount of information being projected about what UFOs are supposed to be. And if you look at the Netflix series, you will see, you know, examples of two problems. And what's interesting about when you look at, you know, something like Top Secret UFO Projects Declassified, What you have is the text. You have the actual things that are being said. They are sitting there. These are not anomalous experiences that someone reports that may or may not be true. We have it, and it is on the record, and we can analyze it. And we can and if you look at so much of what is said in that documentary, which covers pretty well a lot of legitimate information about UFOs, but also it covers the myth that is being developed about UFOs. And if you look at that source, you will find two kinds of deception, which are very clear once you recognize and entertain the possibility that you are being deceived. Then the scales fall off your eyes, and you say, "Wait a minute." One is once again the unconscious contradiction ploy, which I just mentioned. You have in that series story after story after story of the damaging effects of UFOs. And of course, this is now coming out. Recently, the Pentagon just came out with a report which detailed very interestingly the damaging effects, both physically and psychologically, which you know personally have experienced of contact with UFO aliens or whatever they may be. And at the same time, it has admitted a large range of paranormal manifestations that sometimes accompany UFO sightings, including elves, ghosts, spirits, you know, Sasquatches, God knows what, and sexual encounters. And
you're certainly talking to the choir here, because I have had.
Right. But what's interesting is that people like Luis Elizondo and Alejandro Rojas and I guess Chris Mellon and people like that there is a line that nothing negative has ever happened in human alien contact. It's all good. There are no stories of disastrous or negative or toxic encounters. And, you know, this is flying directly in the face of so much evidence. I would like to, at one point, ask you why you think they are denying this. They want to say the UFO aliens are the good guys. Nothing bad has ever happened to anyone through contact with aliens. And that is absurd.
I mean, I'll tell you why I think they say that. I think they say that because they don't know what they're talking about.
Well,
or is it more sinister? Give me your idea, because I'm very interested.
I think it's they want to promote these beings as our spiritual guides and protectors. And so they have to deny how horrible they are and what damaging, you know, painful and destructive things that they do to people.
Well, you know, I have to say that as a close encounter witness, I have gone on a spiritual journey, but it's been my journey. It hasn't got anything to do with, they haven't guided me at all. My journey is my choice.
Well,
let me just finish.
They did not initiate you, you know?
They did not initiate that journey,
but by effecting a radical break with your earlier reality, with consensus reality. Of course, it's your journey, because we're all individuals and everybody has their own path. And yet, they definitely had an effect, wouldn't you say, upon your journey?
Well, they initiated it by abducting me. And you know, my friend Jeff Kripal, whom I've written Supernatural with, says that you can see that as an initiatory experience because it overturned your world.
Yes.
And it did. And that is again and again in the whole phenomenon. You see one witness after another whose world was completely overturned, sometimes by nothing more than the close approach of a UFO.
Yeah.
But this overturning, is there intention behind it? In other words, I made something of the overturning of my world and went all the way from where I was then, which was a secular humanist would be the best way to describe it, to what I am now, which is a person deeply committed to the teachings of Jesus. I've even written a book about it called Jesus, A New Vision. And that started me on that journey. So were they good or evil? What's
well,
going on here?
Many people have been started on a journey like yours by being wounded in war, for example. You go to war, you know, you get a leg blown off, you know, you feel like you don't want to go on with life, and then somehow you gather the resources to go on, and you turn to deeper aspects of reality, and you know, something comes that gives you a new outlook. I mean, any traumatic experience, whether it be paranormal or not, will affect a break with your former reality. You can be kidnapped by terrorists, you know, and kept for 24 months and finally released, and you're going to be a different person. And you know, people may go in a bad direction after that, or they may go in a good direction, in a much deeper direction. But you cannot say that the simple fact that they traumatically broke you with your former way of looking at things is necessarily a vote of confidence in them. You know, I mean, I don't think so.
I don't look at it. I was much more. You know, of course, what Stockholm syndrome is.
Yeah, I was going to bring that up. Right.
Yeah, well, me too. Well, let me just say for the listeners who don't know, and there may be some, Stockholm syndrome is basically what happens when somebody is being persistently oppressed, captured by terrorists or something like that, and they become allied to their oppressors mentally, emotionally. They become, and they begin to, Patty Hearst is a perfect example. The Symbionese Liberation Army people turned her into an ally, even though she was their captive. I think this is a very, very important part of this phenomenon. And I would like you to talk more about it.
Well, you said it. I mean, that is, for one reason or another, a recognized psychological phenomenon. I mean, people who have the power to totally change your worldview seem, from one point of view, you know, to represent reality. They are the wise men. You know, they after your contact with them, you know a lot more than you knew before, even though you may not have sorted it out yet. So for whatever reason, also there's a brainwashing aspect to it. You know, they threaten to kill you, and then they don't. You know, you think your life is over, and then suddenly they don't kill you. You know, and you're immensely grateful. Thank you for not killing me. This is something that was recognized by the North Koreans during the Korean War. You know, some of their methods, and a very common method of mind control and brainwashing, is to alternate terror and relief. And so the relief is so touching and so deeply felt that people can even mistake it for friendship on the part of the people who had just threatened to kill you but didn't. You know, that's one of the things, one of the ways an experience like this can exercise a control over you. There's another question about whether there is an element of demonic near possession in something like this. And if people don't do a radical break with forces that have violated them violated their human integrity and their human dignity, if they do not immediately say, these people are my enemies, I want out, I never want to see these beings again, I want to help protect myself from them, I want to protect other people from them. And if that reaction doesn't take place, which is an abnormal response, to say the least, what that may indicate is simply fear of reprisal. If you turn against these beings who have inserted themselves into your life and are still probably very close to you in one way or another, you know, that the door to them has been opened and they can walk into your life apparently when they please. And if you turn against them, what might they do next time? The first meeting was terrible enough. If you consciously turn against them and say, you know, if you believe in God, say, God, protect me from these beings, you know, save me from these terrible forces. You fear their reprisals. You know, what'll they do to you now? You know, so there's a great, and people may feel, you know, in a situation with the Stockholm syndrome, you know, if the Symbionese Liberation Army can walk into Patty Hearst's protected life and, you know, abduct her and take her, you know, turn her into a terrorist and a bank robber and whatever, holding a assault rifle, you know, this gives anybody the feeling that, well, hey, I don't have any protection. Nothing, they can do this at any time, which may or may not be true in a given instance, but that's the feeling you get. And people are afraid to turn against them because of reprisals. So, now, and I think you know, to admit that these beings who have treated you in this horrible manner and violated you in this way are indeed your enemies is an important step. You know,
I wonder still to this day, in my own life and the lives of so many others like me, exactly what they are. And this is why you're here, because I want you to present your vision of this, because if they are our enemies, then a lot of us are suffering from Stockholm syndrome without realizing it. And we need to face that possibility. It's very important. Now, in the alien disclosure deception, or the subtitle rather, is The Metaphysics of Social Engineering. Now, this aspect of social engineering, you mentioned what's going on now with these disclosures and so forth. Can you tell us a little bit about your vision of this social engineering? Because we talked a little while ago about supposed whistleblowers who never get punished. And something is going on here that is clearly not what is being said. That I will certainly agree with you on. But what would it be? Because I knew Edgar Mitchell quite well. We were good friends, and some of the others as well that you mentioned I've known in one way or another. And Edgar was a deeply inspired man. But he was at the same time, privately, he never spoke much publicly about this. He was extraordinarily wary of these entities. I guess that would be the best way to describe
it. Well, we can start there. They're definitely entities. Yeah.
Yes, they are. Well, and they can be very physical, as I found out. I mean,
yeah. Well, you've asked two questions, and one is, you know, what these beings are, and two, what is the social engineering project that I see having been built around the experience of these beings. So I'll start with the first question. Let me go here to my notes for a second. In my notes, I say that I wanted to say, I claim that my book is the most complete picture of what the UFO aliens are that has yet been produced. Now, I haven't read all the books, and maybe somebody has done better than me, but as far as I know, this is the most complete vision that I have ever seen. And it's basically, let's start with Jacques Vallée, who I think is probably the most reliable ufologist all in all. And he points out three aspects of the phenomenon. He says, they obviously have a physical aspect. They appear in radar. They leave physical traces. They have physical effects on human beings and this. The second one is the psychic / paranormal, which can be separated, but for the present purposes, I'm putting them in the same category. The psychic paranormal aspect, which is, you know, these beings can walk through your walls at night and appear in your dreams and levitate you and do things that are not common in physical reality. Okay, and the third aspect is that there seem to be human deception activities around of this phenomenon, and which is very strange. I mean, this is what Jacques Vallée talked about in his book, Messengers of Deception, particularly the deception, human deception activities around the UFO phenomenon. So how do you put those three together? Well, what you first have to understand is something, you know, an aspect of traditional metaphysics, because what I say is, in short form, I could say my view of what the UFO aliens are is based upon a view of ufology of Jacques Vallée seen through the traditional metaphysics of French metaphysician René Guénon, who didn't invent all of this, because he is known as the founder of the traditionalist or perennialist school. And at its best, the perennialist school is simply a compendium of the esoteric wisdom of the human race on a very high intellectual level. It's not its own particular ideology, although it can go in that direction. But so what Guénon makes clear, and what traditional metaphysics makes clear, is the being existence is arranged hierarchically. You know, it was known in the 18th century as the great chain of being, the ontological hierarchy of being. And at the apex of the hierarchy is the absolute reality, which we know, which we call God. And God manifests or you know, emanates on a lower level, you know, the angelic world, which is partakes of his eternity, and yet is now differentiated into different individual beings. And then the next lower world is the whole psychic world. And the psychic world is more subjective. It's extremely complex. And at the lower border of the psychic world is what some will call the etheric plane. This is the subtle material dimension. And below that, we have physical reality as we understand it, which is what we experience through our five senses and our ideas of reality based upon what our five senses tell us. So this is how reality is organized. So from this point of view, you would say that the UFO aliens, whatever forms they take, and the forms are innumerable. I mean, whether they be reptilians or grays or tall Nordics or whatever they, however they appear, they show the characteristics of the lower tier of the psychic plane, the subtle material plane. And according to this definition, they are identical with what the Muslims call the jinn. And the jinn are not fully spiritual beings. They're subtle material beings. They're usually invisible to us, but they have the power to appear in our world. They can temporarily materialize. According to some accounts, they have their own forms of technology. And that's what the UFO aliens appear to be, the jinn. Now, according to Muslims,
we need to take a brief pause.
Okay.
And we'll be right back, folks. Free Dreamlanders, please listen to these commercials and do what we ask for once. I'm sure you will. And subscribers, why don't you tell your friends about unknowncountry.com? There's no stigma attached to this anymore. Perhaps there should be if Charles is right. But in any case, if you want to explore this, well, let me finish, Charles, because we're going to take a pause right now. If you're going to want to explore this, Unknown Country is a place to do it, where we will show you all sides of all visions of this very complex issue. This is Whitley Strieber. Listen to me now from June of 2010, talking to Alan Lammers about an incredible thing that happened to him on the island of Sulawesi in Indonesia. Here you are in South Sulawesi in the little town in the district of Sandu Batu. You were, what happened? You were told something rather strange.
Well, we were told before we went, like my friends that I work with the NGO, they told me that when you pack, because it kind of happened by accident, I went out to buy a raincoat. It rains quite a bit in this part of the world. And so I went out and I bought a yellow raincoat. And my friend said, I'm sorry, you can't take that to Walla Walla. And I said, well, why not? And he says, well, you can't wear that color. So anyways, excuse me. So I thought, okay, well, what colors can I wear? They said, well, you can only wear black or white. You cannot wear any bright colors, no bright green, especially no yellow. And, you know, that's all you should bring. And I said, well, what would happen? And they said, well, people disappear.
You will find the rest of that story, and it is brain-bending, in the June 5th edition of Dreamland, June 5, 2010 edition of Dreamland in the unknowncountry.com archive. This archive is one of the richest of its kind in the world, probably is the richest of its kind in the world, filled with extraordinary shows, of which this show is certainly one, this show with Alan Lammers. You will never have heard anything like it. It does what Dreamland is here to do. It opens your mind to the fact that we live inside a hidden reality that we prefer not to acknowledge, but not here. Here on unknowncountry.com, we do acknowledge it. We live in it and we love it. Subscribe today. You can't go wrong. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and get started. Charles, before we left the air, you were just about to talk to us about the jinn and their ability to manifest in the physical world. And I would like to once again approach this with two questions. The first question is if you could tell us what their origin is, what our understanding of them is, and where that comes from. And then secondly, what would be their motives for involving themselves with human beings?
Yes, motives is very important. We have to understand that any sentient beings have intent. And there's nothing wrong with asking what their intent might be. We don't want to just treat them as if they were atoms or molecules or stars. They are conscious beings. So, well, the jinn are mentioned in the Quran. You know, they were certainly known to the pre-Muslim Arabs. They're essentially the same beings as the fairies of Northern Europe. They're the beings that the Greeks and Plato and the Platonists called the daimones, from which we get our word demon, which is not entirely the same thing, but the daimones. And in the Middle Ages, Christian Middle Ages, they were called the longa evi, which means the long-lived ones. It's very interesting. C.S. Lewis, his last book was called The Discarded Image, which is basically a story. It's a very scholarly treatment of the pagan sources of the vision of reality held by the Christian Middle Ages, which also had pagan elements. And one of the realities they recognized was the longa evi, which is another name for the fairies. And they weren't sure whether these were fallen angels, whether they were angels demoted to sort of a lower level, or whether they were an independent race of beings that had nothing to do with the angels. This was uncertain in terms of theology, but their reality was recognized. So this is essentially what I think the UFO aliens are. In terms of the jinn, it is said that some of the jinn are Muslim and some are not. In other words, there are those who believe in God, who are faithful and who worship God in their own way. And the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him, was sent as a prophet to both men and jinn. So the Quran is essentially addressed in some ways to the jinn as well. So, but there are also jinn who are not Muslims, who, and you know, some jinn are considered to be following the Christian way, some are considered to be following the Jewish way, but there are others that are not following any belief in God. And these are the beings that pretty much, I would say, should be identified with the Christian demons. Now, there's a very interesting story about the jinn. And this has something, you know, a direct relationship to something I heard. Just last night, I heard your interview with Jeffrey Mishlove about a year ago. And you said a very interesting thing, which actually appears in the Quran. Now, the Quran tells the story of Allah creates Adam in the next world, in the world before this one, before terrestrial world, before Adam is sent to Earth. And he creates Adam and says, this is the being I'm going to send, you know, to be the steward of creation, to rule terrestrial existence. And the angels are freaked out and they say, don't you know what he's going to do, don't you? You know, he's going to shed blood. He's going to do great evil on the earth. And you're going to send this being to be, you know, the center and your vice regent in your terrestrial creation. Why? And all Allah says in return is, I know something that you don't know. And then he commanded Adam to tell the angels all of their names, because they didn't know their own names. Only he knew their names. So he told them their names. And then Allah commands the angels, bow down to Adam. And they all bowed down to Adam, except one who is called Iblis, who later became the Muslim Satan. Now, Iblis was not an angel per se, but he was one of the jinn among the angels, who was allowed into the company of the angels, very much like Loki in Norse mythology was one of the giants, one of the Jotun, who was admitted to the company of the Aesir, the gods in Valhalla. Very similar story. But so he refused to bow down. He said, you know, this, you know, I'm supposed to bow down to a being made of clay, whereas I am made of smokeless fire. Never. I'm superior to him. And so he was cast out by Allah, and he became the devil. Now, what's interesting is one of your experiences with your visitors that you recounted in your interview was that they came to you and they prostrated themselves to you. And they said, you know, if you only knew what a human being was, you know, you are greater than us. You are the center, and we're simply, you know, the periphery, something like this. Well, I mean, that's a motif that's directly out of the Quran. That's what the angels, you know, God commanded the angels to bow down to Adam in exactly that way, because the human being has a preeminence in a certain sense over the angels. The angels are higher beings. They're closer to Allah, but they're not as central. They're all, it's like each angel is based on a particular name of Allah, whereas the human being is formed upon all the names of Allah. We are the epitome of universal manifestation, and everything that is in the universe is also in God's universe, and all the levels of the universe is also in us. That's what makes us the microcosm of the macrocosm. I'm sure you've heard that phrase. So very interesting, you know, that happened to you. And so these beings at that point were obviously differentiating themselves from those beings who first initiated you, and as you revealed in your interview, through raping you. You know, no, the first beings you met were bad news. You know, that they violated you. They showed no respect for your human integrity. In fact, they deliberately violated it. Whereas these beings later come and say, you know, you are greater than us. You are the center of God's creation. You know, and so there's a difference between these two sets of beings here, right? They have obviously different opposite qualities and opposite intent. And this is where we pray for the gift of discernment of spirits, so we can say, not everything that comes from that world is on the same level or has the same intent. And there are ways to differentiate, you know, one influence from another, so we can choose, so we can go in a positive direction and not go to our own destruction. So
folks, there's something broken over here and I can't reappear just yet. Hopefully I'll be able to. There we go. All right. I'm sorry for that.
That happens. That happens.
Right. Well, my listeners know that happens on this show all the time. All kinds of bizarre electronic interference occurs. So far, you've been pretty clean. Does that mean you're a good guy or a bad guy? I don't know. But I would like... Go ahead, please, Charles.
Well, I'm just saying, you know, one of my feelings, which is something that Catholic exorcists have said about demons, in fact, is they can interact with electronic devices. So we never know if this is just a coincidence or whether it's a little bit of message coming from the subtle plane.
Well, you know, well, that's very interesting, because I'd like to talk more about that, because I and many of the people in this experience, many of the people listening to this, do definitely interact with electronic things and put out streetlights and so on and so forth quite routinely. And there's no question about it. It does happen.
Yeah. An interesting story about that is, you know, of course, Jack Parsons.
And yes, I do. And let's talk about that and the black magic of Jack Parsons and NASA.
Yeah, well, you know, Jack Parsons, for those who do not know his story, was a rocket scientist who co-founded the Aerojet Corporation, the Jet Propulsion Laboratory. He was a student of Aleister Crowley, and one of his fellow students was L. Ron Hubbard, who founded Scientology. And, you know, he has a crater named after him on the dark side of the moon. He submitted early plans for the Pentagon building, very integrated into the military industrial complex. But at the same time, he was a pagan magician. He did pagan rituals at his rocket launchings. He declared that his purpose in life was to destroy Christianity. And this guy, you know, if you want to see the interface between magic, particularly black magic, and technology and technocracy in the 20th century, he's the central point. He let the cat out of the bag. So recently I saw on YouTube a video of him, you know, it was some film that was made quite a while ago, of his doing one of his magical operations, which was called the Babylon, B-A-B-A-L-O-N, workings, in which he was invoking a female spirit called Babylon. And he was there. There was some audience you could hear clapping or talking. And he was talking to them and to the filmmaker. And he had this device. And he said, what this is a kind of an electronic Ouija board. And through this, you know, I can talk to Babylon. He says, this is how we invoke demons. So, you know, he had developed a device which allowed beings from the subtle plane to interact with the electronic field or whatever of this device, or the magnetic field, and that this would produce a message, rudimentary message, something like a Ouija board, you know? So there's some question after that. And this leads back to the question of social engineering. There's obviously an attempt to launch the equivalent of a new religion, which says the human race was not created by God, but by the UFO aliens. Therefore, they are our proper guides and spiritual protectors. And this will spell essentially the end of all the traditional religions. Now, this is the line that appears in Top Secret UFO Projects Declassified, the Netflix series. And the question is, who wants this to happen? Who wants this belief system to be adopted by the human race? Who wants the traditional religions that believe in God and consequently in human dignity to disappear? Who?
Yes, it's such a huge question.
Yeah.
Because this, and I talk about this even in communion, that this dismal UFO religion is not worth following at all. And the idea that we were created by aliens, I mean, sure, it's possible that someone interfered with our genetic development. If we found intelligent creatures on another planet who were helpless, and say it was 10,000 years ago, we'd probably be tempted to interfere too, but that wouldn't make us demons. There's something else going on here to try to disempower the individual and hide from him the reality of his soul. Can you speak to that?
Well, yes. I mean, I said to myself, okay, we get back to René Guénon and his metaphysics. One of the things that he talked about was something called the counter-initiation. And he understood that, you know, from the beginning of time, there has been a tradition of God's communication with humanity. This goes back to the idea in Islam that Adam was actually the first prophet, not just the father of the human race and the one who sinned, but he was the first prophet. So God, you know, has been guiding and, you know, teaching humanity through the line of the prophets and in other religions through the avatars and, you know, through the great shamans of the earlier world age, whatever. You know, God has been, the great spirit has been guiding us. But there has been a shadow to this which has gone on all along. And you can see this in the story of Cain and Abel. You can see this in many stories in the Old Testament. You can see this in the Tower of Babel. There has been a shadow or counterfeit religion that has been dogging the tracks of the true line of spirituality from the beginning of the human race. And this is what René Guénon calls the counter-initiation. And what it is, it's like the ego's idea of religion. You know, it's the belief that from psychic information alone, not from spiritual wisdom and insight, but from psychic information, a religion can be developed. And consequently, it's under the rule of the ego, not under the rule of the spirit, which allows us to transcend the ego. So, and certainly one of the forms of this counter-initiation is Satanism. Well, Satanism is coming out of the woodwork now. The Satanists, you know, want to be on the Interfaith Council, and you know, if we don't watch out, they're going to develop an anti-defamation league that will go after you if you say anything bad about the devil. You know, they're very close to
that. I've noticed that. We're really losing focus when Satanism wants to join the conventional religions. If it is Satanism, I mean, maybe they're transforming themselves into something else. I don't know. But it's I have to pause us now.
Yeah.
We have to take another break for our free Dreamlanders, and
we'll
be right back. Where is the unknown country? Is it out there in the stars? Or is it also somewhere else? Is it in us, in you? Unknown country, join us today. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and join us. Join the questions. Join the search. Join the adventure. Unknowncountry.com. There's no place like it in the world. We're talking to Charles Upton. His website, charles-upton.com. His new book the alien disclosure deception, the metaphysics of social engineering. And Charles, before we go more deeply into social engineering, why don't you just finish the thought that we left the air with?
Well, the thought was, I was talking about the counter-initiation, which is sort of the shadow side or demonic counterfeit of true religion, which is also ancient and which has been developing side by side of true divine guidance to humanity since the beginning of human race. And I came to the conclusion there are two things that are elements of you know, the true spiritual tradition that the counter-initiation cannot counterfeit. One is the sense of the human being as paramount and his human dignity as paramount. The beings who, from a subtle plane, who can be called demons at this point, who are patrons of the counter-initiation, may have a certain degree of metaphysical knowledge and tell you versions of spiritual truth, but they can't tell you that the human being is God's chosen representative upon earth, which is what we get from the Quran, because they operate by violating the human form. And so they cannot at the same time say, you know, your human dignity and integrity is the center of God's manifestation on earth. They can't do that. The other thing they can't do, which is very similar, is they can't see absolute reality as good. It is powerful. It is weird. If it isn't actively evil, at least it's very weird and very, you know, and this is very much the idea that we're getting of spiritual realities is that they have a sinister, dark quality. And anybody who thinks that God is good is simply, you know, a foolish Pollyanna type who you know, doesn't know the real score. The real score is God is weird, you know. And of course, God is formidable. There's no question. There's rigor and there's majesty to God, but it's instinct and united with goodness at every point, because goodness is fullness of being, completeness. You know, in goodness, all the possibilities of something are worked out and harmoniously integrated, and it's full, it's complete. Whereas evil is partial, self-divided, at war with itself, you know, filled with holes, filled with incompletions, and therefore it has a sucking quality and wants to take reality from the good and fill in the holes in its configuration, which it can never succeed in doing because it's broken in its essence. So we have to recognize that beings who come to us and say that they can put us in touch with God, but not through the human form. In other words, perhaps through an alien human hybridization project. Is that going to bring us closer to God? No, because we are human beings, and that is our only way to God. This is what Jesus meant, one of the things when he said, none come to the Father but through me, which means none come to the absolute reality except through the integrity of the human form.
So I have seen that business of alien-human hybridization. It's not theoretical in my life. I've seen such a person and interacted with such a person. My listeners know the story already, Charles, but it's a terribly sad story because this was probably the most disturbed individual I've ever seen. He was in constant, ceaseless agony. And what was he? When I first saw him, he was looked like a boy of about 11, and he may well have been a boy of about 11 because I had had sexual contact with one of these creatures about 10 or 11 years before I saw him. Mm-hmm. And he began to live in the woods behind our house in upstate New York. And then when we moved to Texas, he followed us and created such an uproar in the condo complex that people called social services because there was a very strange feral child living there. He could not speak. but he could hear thoughts and he could project his thoughts into your head. And it was a very, very difficult experience to have a relationship with him. I finally succeeded in driving him off. What was he, Charles, in your view?
Well, from the traditional Christian and Muslim standpoint, he was demonically possessed. Very simple. Now, if this begins to have a measurable genetic, component, then you can talk about something like alien human hybridization. But what it essentially is a manifestation of profound demonic possession. So one of the things I want to deal with is the last question is like how we can protect ourselves against these evil forces and work against them. But in any case, I want to simply read you some things here, which, now we're beginning to talk about demons per se. And it's very interesting here. Why someone would ask, why do you think of these beings as demons? I mean, isn't that religious superstition? Well, okay. Now, you know John Mack. Was he a friend of yours? Did you know him?
Yes, I did. I knew John very well, indeed. He was a good friend. And like Jacques Vallée, is also a good friend.
Yeah, well, okay. So this is actually a paragraph from my book. This is my overview of John Mack's view of people who have been experienced alien abduction. He studied in his book something like 100 different cases of abduction, and this is what he came up with. This says, Mack lists, quote, physical and psychological scars of their experience ranging from nightmares and anxiety to chronic nervous agitation, depression, even psychosis, to actual physical scars, puncture and incision marks, scrapes, burns, and sores. He informs us that the alien abductors routinely subject their victims to terrifying and humiliating medical-like procedures. They also voyeuristically view them performing sexual intercourse or themselves have intercourse with them. He speaks of broken marriages and alienation of affection between parents and children as amongst the more common after effects, and says that negative physical and psychological effects persist even in cases where spontaneous healing of chronic or incurable diseases occurs. Okay, that's what Mack says. Now, Mack, the funny thing about Mack is he had a positive view of UFO aliens even after knowing this. He said, well, they're here to administer some hard lessons that we need to learn. All right, that's what you say. Now, compare this to traditional Christian reports of what is called demonic vexation. A lot of this comes from experiences of exorcists. Vexation means, generally speaking, physical attacks by demonic forces. Okay. Now, effects include physical attacks on a person, cuts, burns, scratches, punctures, writing on the skin, bites, beatings, blows that leave bruises, swellings, bloody sores, broken bones, incisions on the skin that spell words or form signs that persist for a certain time and then disappear, and illnesses with unknown causes and unknown cures. Some victims have been the targets of stones, excrement, and feces that seem to have come out of nowhere. Others have been hurled from their beds or down the stairs, tossed in the air or thrown down to the floor or against a wall, or dragged by the hair by an invisible hand. Others have been taken from where they were and transported long distances. There you have abduction. Vexations can break up friendships and isolate a person. A couple who are married or engaged to be married can separate, or to the contrary, two persons could become engaged even though they are incompatible. So you see, this is almost, these are the same symptoms. These are the same manifestations. This is what's understood, has been understood for centuries by Christian and also Muslim exorcists as the activity of demons. That's what, if you put those two accounts together, It is not much of a stretch to say the UFO aliens, at least the ones that act in this manner, are demons. Because, and there's a vast literature describing the effects and of these beings and the ways to counter them. And you know, obviously, the world of ufologists needs to inform themselves of this body of data, because it is immensely relevant. Now, when you talk about what's interesting is the Pentagon is now coming out with reports which seem to corroborate the religious view of what the aliens are. They do not adopt the religious view, but they corroborate it in two ways. One is to talk about the various deleterious effects of UFO encounters, which recently the Pentagon released a lot of reports on this. Secondly, is to admit the various paranormal manifestations that sometimes accompany UFOs. So this is basically what, from several articles on the web, this is what the Pentagon reports are now saying. As for the Pentagon reports, some of the effects of alien encounters are in line with the radiation sickness hypothesis. Now, this is what Luis Elizondo, actually Jack Sarfati as well, whom I'm in touch with, and some other people saying, well, these are not deliberate attacks. These are simply, you know, the UFO craft have a technology, propulsion technology that creates radiation and then makes people sick who get near it. But that may be legitimate in certain circumstances, but some of the effects of alien encounters are in line with the radiation sickness hypothesis, but others clearly go beyond this explanation. The Pentagon documents state that people who observed unidentified flying objects frequently displayed a cluster of similar physical symptoms, injuries consistent with exposure to electromagnetic radiation, such as burns, heart ailments, and sleep disturbances. A report speculates that these could be caused by energy-related propulsion systems. On the other hand, there were accounts of apparent abduction as well as encounters with ghosts, yetis, spirits, elves, and other mythic legendary entities, 5 cases of sexual encounters, nightmares, voice loss, eye injuries and amnesia, breathing problems, weight loss, paralysis, and experiences of perceived telepathy, teleportation, and levitation. So what you have, there's a great consonance between what John Mack saw from his abductees, what the Pentagon is seeing from its sources, and what Catholic exorcists have always known and attributed to demons. So the demonic hypothesis got a great boost from the Pentagon very recently, even though they're not going to come out and say that they are demons. But the evidence they give is entirely in line with that hypothesis. So
we have come to the end of the first hour of our show, and in this third half hour, we're going to circle back. We're going to do two things. We're going to talk about what how Charles defines demon, and how that compares to jinn, and what the relationship is. And we're also going to circle back to Jack Parsons and the injection of black magic into our official scientific endeavor in the United States, and what the significance of that is to this day. Free Dreamlanders, I would like to thank you very much, as always, for being with us. And subscribers, we will keep right on keeping on with this very provocative conversation.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by unknowncountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host, and I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.